Now, when I started this year doing this retro wrestling review series, I knew eventually I was going to get to this point. In fact, I intentionally tried to punt this until December, because every time I would do a video and then say, what do you want me to review? This pay-per-view would always come up. Every time I would post a question on social media, Twitter, Facebook, this pay-per-view would always come up. You sick, sadistic bastards. And of course, watching this show once in my lifetime wasn't bad enough. Because of all of you, and yes, I blame you for this, I have now watched this show from beginning to end twice in my life, which will be two more times than any sane wrestling person would ever voluntarily choose to watch this show, and will also mark the last time in my entire life that I ever sit down to watch ECW December to Dismember 2006. Dismember being the key word, because after this show, you wanted to dismember yourself, or maybe gouge out your eyeballs, hit yourself in the head repeatedly, for how stupid you felt about watching the show once. I've watched it now twice in my lifetime. And going back to this time in WWE 2006, with the success of the ECW One Night Stand shows and the launching of the ECW brand as its own entity within WWE, you know, the WWE was trying to take a property that they owned in the ECW name and brand and tried to get a massive return on their investment. And the One Night Stand shows were very successful from a business standpoint. So it made sense to try and continue to squeeze the blood out of that turnip as much as they could. So at this moment, I completely understood where the WWE was trying to go. But then you get to December to Dismember, and everything goes off the rails so quickly. Let's take an ECW brand and a pay-per-view name and permanently ruin both forever. Irrevocably, there is no way to get it back. Nothing says ECW like holding an ECW branded pay-per-view in Augusta, Georgia. Augusta, Georgia. After this, you're going to go stand outside the Masters and watch as all the white people celebrate and nobody else is let in. And then to really kind of top this off, on December 3rd, 2006, let's book a show and plan a show for this ECW brand 1 week, 1 week after Survivor Series 2006, when we're still using the old pay-per-view business model, meaning there are a couple hundred thousand people, your fans that have already paid the $40-$50 for Survivor Series. Now you're going to turn around a week later and expect them to do the same in kind. Let's only promote two of the six actual matches that are on the main card, because we didn't know what the hell we were doing. We didn't know where we were going with this. This wasn't well planned out. It wasn't thought out, because you threw it together at the 11th hour like it was a Raw or a SmackDown or an ECW television taping, because you again literally decided to have this like 1 week after Survivor Series. And then, after only wanting to promote two of the six matches that are actually on the card and being bothered to do so, let's only have one of those said promoted matches actually feature past or present ECW brand talent. Oh, that's gonna put the asses in the seats. And then on top of all of that, let's have the show be a complete choppy mess and end about, it seems like, a half hour before it really should have. And you understand, in part, why the attendance was bad for this event, why the pay-per-view buy rate was historically shitty for ECW December to Dismember 2006. I think it was like 50-something thousand, 58,000 domestic pay-per-view buys. Internationally, less than 100,000, like 90,000 pay-per-view buys. I mean, this was historically bad, historically terrible, and it was appropriate for the show. And make no mistake about it, this show is god-awful. This is one of those things that you point to, and you say, everything you want to do with professional wrestling in a professional wrestling show, you watch this and you say, this is how you learn not to do it. This is what you don't do. Because this thing was a steaming pile of crap. You kick it off with Eminem, Mercury, and freaking Morrison, or excuse me, Johnny Nitro at the time, excuse me, with their manager Melina taking on the Hardy Boys. And of course, neither one of these teams, none of the talent on these teams at the time were actually ECW branded, but at least this was something that actually had some story heading into it. The company at least cared enough to build up to this match. Most everything else in this card, no, but this one they did. Of course, when you look at it, this was at the time where Melina was still wearing her skirt, so of course when she did that splits entrance, the camera cut away from her ass just as she was doing the splits. And this just kind of lets you know the beginning, how this night was going to go. This was easily one of the best matches on the card, and that really truly is not saying shit. Because this was back when Johnny Nitro couldn't work at all, not that he can even work now, but he was really, really green as goose shit then, and he was bad. There was plenty of choppiness, a couple of nice things mixed in. But you got to the point where Melina's screaming was horrible and the crowd let her know. The crowd was not really getting into it until maybe the very end. This match went way too damn long, at least 5 minutes, if not 10 minutes too long. There just wasn't enough story. There wasn't enough interest to have this match go 22 some damn odd minutes. The Hardy Boys win, and it's kind of like, thank God that is over. And I have now watched this match twice in my lifetime. Shame on me. Shame on me. This feels like one of these moments where I want to tell myself, and this was the best thing on the show. Get a clue, get laid, get a life. That's what I want to tell myself right now, for putting myself through this a second time. Because after this, it just went all downhill. And it's not like you were very high up the hill anyways. It's like that Eminem versus the Hardy Boys match was halfway up the bunny hill on a ski at a ski resort. And you've got all the different intermediates, advanced, the black diamond, all that other crap. This was halfway up the bunny hill. And again, it all went down the cliff from here. Matt Stryker versus Balls Mahoney. Now, I'm actually a fan of the heel teacher gimmick that Matt Stryker had back then, the old social studies teacher. And I feel like it could work in that environment where it's supposed to be extreme wrestling and, you know, supposed to be no rules and anything goes. Here's a guy that's saying, I want extreme enforcement of the rules. But as you're watching this match, you realize the only extreme enforcement of a rule there was apparently Pat Patterson paid somebody a 20 spot to make sure they got numerous shots of Matt Stryker's trunks and his junk in this match. I'm trying to hate. I'm just saying I didn't need that many shots of his trunk and his non-Randy Orton raging ring boner, okay? Just wasn't necessary. It seemed like that's what this match was telling in terms of a story was Matthew Stryker's trunks. You had shitty moves with zero chemistry and a completely, totally flat-ass finish. And, of course, Balls Mahoney went over, and it was terrible. And we move on. Elijah Burke and Sylvester Turkay taking on the FBI. It was like Germany versus Italy. And when you think Germany, when you look at the ring gear, nothing says Germany like Elijah Burke. I'm just saying. Another one of these, and you had several of these match concepts here, right in the heart of the card, where it was old ECW versus new ECW. Another one of those, and this was another clunker. The fans didn't care. The guys aren't very good. Then, once Elijah Burke, for all intents and purposes, used the stroke as the finish, and then Sylvester Turkay hits the freaking muscle buster on whoever the hell it was from the FBI, you've got the crowd chanting TNA, TNA. This is back in 2006, mind you, so this was an unreasonable thing for the fans to chant TNA, TNA. That's how bad this match was, and that's how quickly downhill this show was going. And mind you, this was not in Philly, this was not in New York, this was not in a bastion, the heart of ECW fandom. This was in Augusta, Georgia, where they have the fucking Masters. And they were chanting TNA, TNA. Just think about that for a second. Daivari versus Tommy Dreamer, which was basically Wrestle City with some unathletic Dreamer spots mixed in, especially the one running Tree of Woe move that he had. That was just god-awful bad. It's like, could you be any slower and whiter? And Tommy Dreamer says, well, of course I could, because I'm hardcore. This was hardcore doo-doo. Daivari wins via roll-up and not quick enough, in my opinion. Kali earlier on had interfered and he got thrown out just so that way Daivari would still win via roll-up anyways, and then Kali would come out and smash freaking Dreamer into the damn ramp or platform area, whatever you want to call it. And I just think about it, is like you couldn't set it up where you threw Dreamer into some foam or some padding, you know, like the traditional old Jeff Hardy jumps from 30 feet down the ladder and you see the foam and padding go flying when he lands. Imagine telling Tommy Dreamer for that this piece of shit show that we're going to ask you to take that wicked ass bump for no real reason or no purpose when you've already put over Daivari. Now you're being asked to put over Great Khali, and everything about this was terrible. You get where I'm going with this. Then, if that wasn't bad enough, you got Kevin Thorne and Ariel versus Mike Knox and Kelly Kelly. And once you get past Kelly Kelly wishing CM Punk good luck, because that was her on-screen crush at the time, you got a sloppy match with a stupid-ass finish. And it seemed like the only reason this was even put together was for Mike Knox to say fuck off to Kelly Kelly and then get Sandman to come in and hit some people with a kendo stick. To which I said, at this point in time in the show, I wish Sandman would come to my house to hit me with the kendo stick for being stupid enough to have watched this a second go round. Oh God, this was bad. And you're getting to this point where you're like, no matter how good the main event is, it can't save it. No matter what's going to happen in that main event, this is a terrible show. And mind you, the crowd had already been pissed off early on in the night with what happened with one guy being replaced and Hardcore Holly being put in there in his place. Nothing says ECW like freaking not Crash Holly. We still had the main event. Oh my God. The Elimination Chamber. And now, nothing says ECW in an ECW brand, in an ECW show, in an ECW main event, like a WWE-created match stipulation, match gimmick like Elimination Chamber. Now, that said, it does kind of fit into the whole premise of Extreme Rules and so on and so forth. And in this case, it was going to be an extreme Elimination Chamber match with guys carrying out crowbars and all this other crap. But think about that. This is ECW. When you think of old ECW main events, you would think of the Triple Threat, something like that. You wouldn't think of a six-person Elimination Chamber match. Then, during the middle of the show, because of backstage politics and people not liking Sabu and thinking that he's not good here, and ultimately because we want to sit there and have three heels in the match so that way Lashley has more heels to work off of, we take Sabu out, which elicits the response from the crowd of bullshit, bullshit, because again, we thought it was a good idea to take an ECW original like Sabu in a match that was actually perfectly suited to his skill set. Like Elimination Chamber, where it doesn't matter if things are smooth or anything else, you just bump and flip and do all this other crazy shit. Like, that's Sabu. That's the only thing that fucker could do all those years ago. Now, that's all he can do. So, you don't want to put him in that match concept that seems to perfectly suit his skills and what he can do? And then you decide you're going to replace him with Hardcore fucking Holly? And then, oh, it gets worse. You've got CM Punk a week before Survivor Series. When the fans are supposed to be chanting for DX, they're chanting for CM Punk, CM Punk, CM Punk on that 5-on-5 tag match. This is like the perfect moment and opportunity to launch this new brand, this new vision, and say we're going to go with a new guy and somebody that kind of fits that mold of somebody that would have been successful at ECW. And that would have seemed a perfectly suited CM Punk at this point in time. And of course, Paul Heyman was an advocate for it. I believe Big Show was an advocate for trying to make CM Punk. Vince McMahon said no. He said, let's not make him champion. Let's have him get eliminated by fucking RVD relatively quickly and be a non-factor. Because we really needed RVD to last longer in this match than CM Punk, right? Especially if they weren't the final two. And then let's have Test, yes, that Test, eliminate RVD Punisher style, and then just stand around. This shit was put together so poorly that you have multiple gaps in an Elimination Chamber match where a guy isn't wrestling another guy. In this case, Test has like a minute or so to just sit there and stand around and look stupid and wait for Lashley to come in. And then going back to the point I made about putting Hardcore Holly in instead of Sabu trying to sit there and say, you're giving Bobby Lashley more obstacles to go through. This is just nonsensical Vince bullshit because you put Hardcore Ali in there to give you, in theory, three heels along with a Test and along with a Big Show. And then you only bother to actually have Lashley wrestle two of them because Holly is gone by the time Lashley gets in the fucking match. Because, of course, that makes a lot of sense. And then let's have Lashley eliminate Test in a couple of minutes and then again just stand around. But in this case, he's going to go at Big Show's pod with a chair and all this other crap. And then the crap they did before, even when Lashley was supposed to go in, this stupid-ass idea of the security guards trying to lock Lashley in and then he's trying to go through a table and he's trying to do this. It was just fucking terrible. And then when you got to Lashley and Big Show, it was just terrible. And at this point in time, it was enough was enough. And you would think, me being the alleged cuck for the black man, that I would be all giggly tits about a Bobby Lashley winning the ECW world title here, but I wasn't. I wasn't back then, and going back and watching it, I most certainly wasn't now. Like, there were so many directions this company could have gone, and this is where they ultimately went. Lashley wins, the people largely don't care, and it was fucking dumb. It was terrible. This show was so bad that it marked the end of Paul Heyman in WWE, because him and Vince were battling in the lead up to this, and Heyman saying they're going to hold this against us, they're going to shit all over this, da da da. They sent him home, they tried to pin this on Paul Heyman, when you know goddamn good and well anybody with a brain looks at this show and knows that not every show Paul Heyman did was great, but in no way, shape, or form was there anything that points to Paul Heyman having any positive fingerprints on this show whatsoever. It was literally like, yeah, we'll bring you in, Paul, and we'll do this, and we'll do this, and then they did everything to undercut him, everything to do it their way, so that way they could do it in their image and their likeness and fucking ruin it. This was the last ECW-branded pay-per-view. They all became tri-branded after this, and you wonder why. It was a huge business failure, because again, we're going to have it 1 week after Survivor Series, and then we're going to do this shit, and again, nothing says ECW like Augusta, Georgia. This show, if you want to know how bad this show is, I don't care what anybody wants to say, revisionist history my ass, I will always believe that this show was so bad that it made Big Show retire the first time in 2006. Like, he wrestled RVD, I think, that following week on ECW, and that was it. And the reason being is Big Show knew he wanted no part of this. He knew he didn't want to have anything to do with this. So you can believe that his body was broken down, he was burned out, and all this other bullshit. No, the simple truth of the matter is Big Show saw where this turd Ferguson sandwich of ECW was going. And he wanted no part of it. He said, I'm going to take some time off. You can keep your money. I'll come back later. And that's exactly what he did. This show was so bad that Paul Heyman no longer wanted a part of it. Even if he did, he wasn't going to anymore, and Big Show retired. This show was terrible. Now, in the interest of fairness, as bad and terrible as this show was, I think now, as we go back and look through the scope of history 11 years later, I think it is fair to say that as bad as this show was, we have seen worse shows just in the past couple of years. I've never felt December to Dismember 2006 was the worst WWE pay-per-view of all time. I didn't even think it belonged on the Mount Rushmore of WWE worst pay-per-views of all time. And I still don't to this day. And in fact, I think history has been a little kinder to it. Not because this show is better or ages well. No, it's still terrible. It's still shit. It's still everything bad that everybody has ever said about it. This company in recent years has put together so many bad, crappy shows that has really lowered the standard in terms of what is bad or crappy or what is good. And as a result, in relation to that, December to Dismember just doesn't look as bad. This is still terrible. Please don't ever, 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 ever watch this show. Any of you that have ever watched this show, oh my God, I'm sorry. I feel your pain. If you were actually dumb enough to buy this pay-per-view in 2006, I want to hear your story of why you thought that was a good idea. If any of you happened to actually go to this event live in 2006 from Augusta, Georgia, or anywhere in that area, I would really, really like to hear from you your thought process of why you thought it was a good idea to buy a ticket to the show, then go to the show, and what you thought about the show once it actually happened. But this show is bad. Really, really bad. But nowhere near the worst in WWE history. And don't ever let anybody tell you it is, because that's a load of crap. We've seen worse shows, in my opinion, in 2017. This is just one of these ones that really, really sucks. And as you could hear in the background, Summer agrees.